Good morning and welcome to Church of the Redeemer worship this morning. A just peace and open and affirming congregation. No matter where you are on your journey, know that you matter. Thank you for joining this morning and please feel free to, as we go along, you'll have opportunities to be able to talk to each other and let yourself be known. Please join us for Bible study on Monday at 1 p.m. We will use this same platform. We will be using Zoom. And that link is on the church's website under resources. If you would like to join, please contact the church at church@corucc.org for the password. And I hope you will join me. Congratulations. Thanks to your hard work and asking folks to like our YouTube channel, we reached 100 this week. And so we have a name. And our 100th subscriber was our own Holly Millershank. So that was exciting. And we are now Redeemer UCC Westlake on YouTube. This morning in UCC churches across the country, we recognize Pacific Islander and Asian American ministries. In this time when Asian Americans are facing increased discrimination, we are proud to have ministries across our denomination that recognize their value. The church is continuing to function even if the building is closed. I encourage you to reach out to each other in some form of communication, whether it is text or mail or phone call or even a handwritten note. Thank you to everyone who has continued to practice supporting the church with your monetary gifts. If you would like to support the church or any of our specific funds, you may mail your gifts for God to the church office at 23500 Center Ridge Road, Westlake, 44145, or you can take advantage of our online giving, which is now easy and available on the church website. And you should have also received some directions about that on Thursday, I believe. If you have not received the worship materials for this morning, either via email or in the mail, please go to our website at corucc.org and click on the resources file to find those resources. This morning, we will gather together in a call to worship, a hymn, a prayer of invocation, a middle hymn, a message for young Christians, and a closing hymn. We also get the treat of a solo by Carol Peddie. I will offer a message and a pastoral prayer. We will begin worship with a prelude entitled Jesus Paid It All, arranged by Mark Hayes and played by our organist Jason Aquila. Thank you for being with us today as we continue to participate in worship using technology. We know that no matter where we are, God is with us. Let us be in an attitude of worship and let us quiet our hearts as we listen to the prelude. Let us join together in our call to worship. Travelers on the way, what shall we do? We shall pray
God, hears our prayers,
who draws near to us and brings new life again. Dear ones, how shall we live?
With the confidence of God's beloved children,
with security and joy of God's saviors. Friends old and new, what is the promise? New life, forgiveness of sins,
care as a gift.
Beloved siblings, how shall we praise?
God.
We lift our voices and our hearts in love, thanks, and praise. We will praise the Lord as long as we live. I invite you to join in singing Love Divine, All Loves Excelling.
Prayer of invocation. Loving God, come and speak to our hearts today. May we,
find your words burning with hope in our lives.
Strengthen us and give us courage.
We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
There's a children's message.
Okay, can you hear me? Yes, okay. Today's scripture, which you'll hear read in a bit, is about two of Jesus' followers who were walking on the road in the later part of the day of resurrection. And Jesus comes near, but they don't recognize him. They have a whole conversation with him while they walk, but it isn't until they arrive home and ask him to stay for dinner, and Jesus breaks the bread, that they remember him breaking the bread before, and they recognize him. I don't know about you, but being shut up in the house all day, I sometimes find myself walking around and looking through cupboards and closets and drawers, and I find lots of things that I thought I had lost. But sometimes I see something that's been out in the open all along, and my eyes haven't let me really recognize it. And often when I do, it's because the item makes me remember someone. The latest time that happened was this week. I walked into our study, and on the cabinet, I saw a pair of bells that had sat in my house since my longest, earliest memory. I think my parents might have gotten them as a wedding gift. And I instantly thought of my mom. Not in the kind of way of saying, oh, those were my mom's bells, isn't that nice? It was, I remembered my mom in a way that she was standing right next to me. And I felt it so much that I just wanted to say, and I think I actually did, oh, hi, Mom. I'm sure that today you could walk around your house, and if you're really looking, you could find items that make you remember someone, maybe someone who's passed that you miss, or maybe family or friends that you're just not allowed to be with right now. I think that you could walk around and look for something that actually makes you think of Jesus and makes you feel Jesus' presence so strongly that you too might want to say, oh, hi, Jesus. Jesus is risen in a way that we can not only just remember him, but we can experience him with us each and every day, if only we open our eyes to see. Let us pray. Oh God, help us not only to remember Jesus and all that he did in his life, let that remembering open our eyes to see all the ways that Jesus is still with us today. May we feel your love on whatever roads we walk. Amen.
To his own home. flesh and blood his substance. He took the form of man, revealed the hidden plan. O glorious mystery, sacrifice of Calvary.
Scripture this morning is from Psalms 116, verses 1 through 4 and 12 through 19. I love God because God has heard my voice and has heard my supplications. Because God inclined an ear to me, therefore I will call on God as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me, the pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of God. O God, I pray, save my life. What shall I return to God for God's bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of God. I will pay my vows to God. I will pay them in the presence of all God's people. Precious in the sight of God is the death of God's faithful ones. O God, I am your servant and the child of your servant. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice. I will call on the name of God. I will pay my vows to God in the presence of all God's people. In the courts of the house of God, in your midst, O Jerusalem, praise be to God. The second reading is from Acts chapter 2, verses 14a through 36 through 41. But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. Men of Judea, all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah. This is Jesus, whom you crucified. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven. You will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, for the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 persons were added. Our God is still speaking. Thanks be to God.
Our scripture reading this morning from the Gospel of Luke. chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. May God add a blessing to the hearing and the understanding of these words. Let us pray. God, who appears to us along the roads we travel, as we gather together to hear your word, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts burn within us and be acceptable in your sight. You who are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. This week in Bible study, we talked about various stories that had happened to us along the road. And oftentimes those roads were our work environments or literally being out and about and things happening. We shared stories about how we had had opportunities to help others and how others had helped us, both physically helped us and also changed the way that we looked at things. Right now, our roads may consist of walking from our living room to the kitchen to the bathroom these days. but we are still on a road and Jesus is walking with us. We have yet another Easter story this week, but this time from the book of Luke and from Luke's telling. If you think about it, Luke's stories frequently take us on the road. He is one of the gospel writers who tells the story of Mary and Joseph being on the road. Luke tells the story of the Good Samaritan who walks by on the road. It is a road that leads the prodigal son back to his father and his family. And it is a road that leads Jesus into Jerusalem. We are still on Easter Day in this story. We don't know why Cleopas and his companion, who remain nameless, which, given biblical history, I have to wonder if Cleopas's companion was a woman, since she was nameless. They were walking to Jerusalem, 7 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And think about it. There, they walked that 7 miles, and then as soon as they recognized Jesus, they walked back. Many of us have been going out for walks during this time, and a 2 mile walk might take us half an hour, 45 minutes, depending on how briskly you are walking. But imagine walking 7 miles and then turning around and walking that again. We don't really know why they took off from Jerusalem. Perhaps it was fear of the authorities. But Jesus just kind of ambles up beside them, just another person walking along the road. There's no grand appearance like some of the other Easter stories that we've heard in which he comes through closed doors. He's just walking along. And he walks up alongside Cleopas and his companion. And then the writer of Luke is very explicit about what their feelings are. He says they are sad. They are grieving. They feel like their hope has been lost. And they are utterly flabbergasted that this stranger hasn't heard about all of this. And isn't it interesting? They tell to Jesus the story, and Jesus tells back to them how he plays a role in that story. And yet, they don't recognize him, because he was simply another traveler on the road with them. There's no mention of their hearts burning while he listens, like they say. So you have to wonder, here they are so honest, the writer is so honest about them being sad. But it is not until later that they reflect that, yes, our hearts were burning when we heard that story. And as they reach Emmaus, Jesus is yet again unassuming. He acts as if he's just going to keep on walking. And then they extend the invitation. And then he accepts. It is in that simple act of breaking and blessing and sharing the bread that he becomes recognizable. It isn't something flashy. It isn't something grand. It isn't something big. It is in that little thing of breaking the bread, blessing it, and sharing it. Jesus is in the little things for us in the midst of this time. I remind you each week, both during worship and during the things that I send you, that God loves you and that God is with you. But what are the little things where you are seeing Jesus? An expression of appreciation from a neighbor, a simple smile and a wave to a stranger or from a stranger, the wearing of masks. It is in that wearing of masks that it is the little things in which we see Jesus. But there are things that we can do to show that we are followers of Jesus. Little things, not big things. Things like a phone call. Things like a letter in the mail. And at this time when the Postal Service is saying our business is down and there are threats to that Postal Service, sending a letter not only is doing that little thing that Jesus would do, helping somebody else who receives that, but also helping the Postal Service in the midst of it. Perhaps you want to make a special dinner for someone in your house. I don't know about you, but this has been a whole new learning curve to think every single night. I feel like my mother back in the 60s and 70s. What are we going to fix for dinner? But what if you made that dinner a little special? This morning, as I was scrolling through Facebook, I saw the daughter of one of my college friends, a high school senior this year, and last night would have been her prom. She got dressed up. They set a card table with a tablecloth and candles. And there was this beautiful picture of her dancing with her dad. It was a little thing, but it was a glimpse of Jesus. Perhaps you have all that fabric sitting around and you don't know what to do with it. And maybe, trust me, I am not assuming this, maybe you have some time that you don't know what to do with. If you do, maybe that fabric can become masks to help keep others safe and to help keep you safe. Jesus reminds us that to be a follower, simplicity is all that is needed. We don't have to be big and grand. And in this time when our energy may wax and wane and we have good days and bad days, doing the simple things is a way to live your faith. So I ask you, what simple thing will you do this week to let others know you are a follower of Jesus? Amen.
Thank you.
We come to the time in the service that we can bring our prayers before God. Those things that we celebrate during this time, and also those things that cause us trouble. I invite you to remember Kathy Moore and her family as her mother died this week. It had been a long illness, but nonetheless, a loss for that family. I invite you to join in prayer, and let us begin with a time of silent prayer. Journeying God, this morning we journey towards you, giving thanks and praise that you are beside us. As we journey, we sometimes believe that we do not need you as a companion, but instead can do it on our own. Forgive us for our arrogance. We know that when we fail to welcome you on our journey, we oftentimes meet dangers for which we are unprepared. Thank you for walking alongside us, even when we don't ask you to do so. As we journey in the midst of this pandemic, we admit to our fears, knowing that our fear is not the opposite of hope, but merely part of our human condition. And so we come in fear, in doubt, in grief, and in hope, knowing you are beside us, just waiting for the fire in our hearts to be ignited. We pray for Pacific Islander and Asian American ministries in the UCC, even while others in our world spread hate and falsehoods about our Pacific Islander and Asian American siblings. We pray for all of the frontline workers who continue to work to ensure our health and safety. We pray for those who are grieving, often feeling alone due to physical distance. We pray for the families of all those impacted by COVID-19, those who have had a loved one die, and those who are fearful of their loved one contracting the disease. We pray for our church community as we continue to find new ways to be the church, not only among ourselves, but among the world. We pray a prayer of thanksgiving for all those who are finding ways to support one another through phone calls, notes, and sewing of masks. We pray for those we now name out loud.
In
Pamela Bloomingdale.
Shirley.
Family of Carol Matthews.
Connie.
My friends all over the world.
Vicky.
Andy.
Virus.
For all the people grieving, Amy. And for peace in the world, and anybody that doesn't have somebody to pray for.
Workers.
Faithful and simple God, we know that during this time, we are called to do the simple things, just as Jesus did. Help us to see where you are calling us to be your faithful, simple servants. We pray this in the name of the one who taught us, saying,
our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
Friends, as you go out this week, find something little to show others that you are a follower of Jesus. And may you love God so much that you love nothing else too much. And may you fear God just enough that you need not fear anything else at all. Go in peace. Amen. Our postlude, played by our organist Jason Aquila, is Presto from Piano Sonata No. 28 by Haydn.